Hello everyone, welcome to Analog IAS Current Affairs Analysis for 18th February 2020. These are the articles that we'll be dealing today. First article for the day is taken from the Hindu and it is titled Women at Arms. The Supreme Court on Monday ordered that the government must implement its permanent women commission in the armed forces immediately without any delay. Previously, the Delhi High Court ruled that women officers should be treated on par with the male counterparts. However, that never took off and this case was filed way back in 2003 and it was never implemented and challenged by the central government. So, in the present context, what are the implications of this case and what is the actual background of this case? Let us try to understand that. In 1992, the induction of women officers in the army started. So, they were commissioned for a period of 5 years in certain chosen streams such as Army Education Corps or Corps of Signals, Intelligence Corps or Corps of Engineers. And there was a shorter pre-commission training period than male counterparts who were commissioned under the Short Service Commission scheme. This was for male counterparts. And for women, under the Women Special Entry Scheme, they had, like I've already mentioned, very shorter pre-commission training period, and in 2006, this scheme was replaced with the SSC scheme, which was extended to women officers also. They were commissioned for a period of now 10 years from 5 years, and it was also extendable till 14 years depending upon various conditions. So, the serving women officers were given the option to move to this new scheme or to continue under the erstwhile old scheme, that is WSCS. They were to be, however, restricted to roles in streams specified earlier only. While male officers were allowed to opt for permanent commission at the end of this 10 years, women officers did not get this provision. Thus, they were kept out of the command appointment and could not qualify for government pension. Because government pension generally starts only after 20 years of service as an officer. The first batch of women officers under the new scheme entered the army in 2008. In 2003, a public interest litigation was filed before the Delhi High Court for granting of permanent commission to women SSC officers in the army. In September 2008, the Defense Ministry came out with a notification that it would allow permanent commission for SSC women officers in two particular departments, that is the Judge Advocate General Department and the Army Education Corps, but not all the departments. So, even this order was challenged because it was selective in nature and it is not being considered by women officers because it is not on par with men. In 2010, the Delhi High Court passed an order saying that all the women who retired during the judicial proceedings would have to get the benefits on par with men. And all the women officers who were made to retire before their superannuation can get permanent commission again. But the Defense Ministry never implemented this because it challenged this decision in the Supreme Court. But the Supreme Court in its latest order denied any such gender stereotypes and made a remark that sex stereotypes premised on assumptions about socially ascribed roles of gender which discriminate against women are against the right to equality under Article 14 and hence women are eligible to get permanent commission on par with men. Now with Supreme Court passing such an order, the armed forces and especially the defense ministry will have no other option but to change their attitude and culture, and especially their human resource management team should work towards inculcating this culture and integrating women into their workforces on a permanent commission. That is the gist of this article. This is yet another progressive step towards gender equality taken by the Supreme Court in the past couple of years, both in the terms of personal law as well as including the social rights, especially in the context of genders. The Supreme Court has passed some remarkable judgments in the past couple of years. whether it is the law on adultery or whether treating internet as a basic right or right to privacy, decriminalizing section 377, all these articles together form the facet of reformative constitutionalism or transformative constitutionalism, as they put it. Now, this decision can also be added as a part of that new phase of constitutionalism exhibited by the Supreme Court. The next article for the day is taken from the Hindu and it is titled, May the Force Be Strengthened. Now, if we take a look at the central armed police forces, there are various forces. CRPF is one amongst them. What is the need for having these paramilitary forces when actually the law and order is a state subject as per the 7th schedule of our constitution? Normally, in emergency situations, the role and performance of this central armed police forces is very efficient and therefore assumes a great significance due to the special features of an emergency force, which is pressed in aid to civil power to perform multiple roles in extremely difficult situations. That is why CRPF is extremely important despite having state police forces. And amongst them, CRPF has a special place. CRPF stands for Central Reserve Police Force and basically includes Rapid Action Force as well as COBRA, that is Commando Battalion for Resolute Action. So, both these constitute CRPF. Despite being such an efficient force, CRPF is one of the most toughest jobs because of the extreme conditions these soldiers work in. If we take the case of last year's Pulwama attacks, it has been almost 1 year since that incident has happened and there are no structural reforms in organizing the CRPF forces. The central issue here is the extreme conditions in which this CRPF jawans work, and they are deprived of normal living conditions. And recently our Home Minister Amit Shah promised that a soldier would get 100 days of leave and time to spend with his family. There have been instances where the psychological health of these jawans have been affected and they either committed suicide or went into an aggressive mode and attacked their fellow soldiers. Now, looking at the present requirement, 100 days of leave is next to impossible for a CRPF jawan. So, instead of working towards increasing the CRPF workforce in the long run, what can the government actually do? That is the central question raised by this article writer. Instead of saying that only CRPF jawan should function in anti-insurgency campaigns, the CAPF can actually do well by mandating that the rest of the forces should also participate in anti-insurgency operations in the initial days of their career, and later they can move towards their static jobs. This way, when they are young and when they are actually passing through a similar process, they can bear the burden simultaneously. This will also reduce the impact on CRPF and also increase the efficiency of the Central Armed Police Forces. Also, the long overdue non-functional financial upgradation has materialized, but the IPS officer who are leading these forces on deputation are reluctant to implement that scheme. Now, what is this non-functional financial upgradation? It is highly impossible that all the officers who are recruited under these forces get promotion equally. So, in order to compensate for that, there is a provision that allows officers a raise in salary and perks in keeping with the pay grade of the next rank as well when they cannot be promoted. This is because of lack of vacancies. Even this is not being implemented. There is no provision of rehabilitation after voluntary retirement by many officers. Also, there should be consideration for one rank, one pension scheme for CRPF jawans as well. On the first anniversary of this Pulwama attacks, we should try to implement all these measures and see that the life of these jawans who lay down their lives for the security of this country becomes a reality. The next article for the day is titled, The 5 Trillion Arithmetic and this is taken from the Indian Express. This article is written by Mr. Kaushik Basu, and he talks about why the 5 trillion economy by 2025 is a tough target to achieve. If we take a look at the present GDP, it is somewhere around $2.75 trillion. Now, in the last quarter, the growth rate estimated by Indian government is 4.75%. If we assume the same performance, it would take nearly 10 years more to achieve this target of 5 trillion economy. Now, the real question that we have to ask is, does it really matter? Does 5 trillion economy matter without taking into consideration the other macroeconomic aspects like inflation, GDP growth, or to that matter, should we consider the exchange rate as well? Without considering all these macroeconomic factors, it is futile to talk about a 5 trillion economy because there would be no actual value addition to the economy. Now, if we take into consideration the investment to GDP ratio, which is very crucial for a real growth in an economy, it has crashed to a low of 30% from 39% in 2007-2008. Now, we have to get this back up to see any real growth in our economy. A few policymakers, including the government officials, have been relying upon nominal growth. Now, let us try to understand this nominal GDP growth as a factor for growth in India. Imagine a situation in an economy which produces, say for example, only bikes. In the base year 2015, the economy produced only 3 bikes and the price of each bike was 1 lakh. As per the definition of GDP, it is the sum of all the goods and services produced in an economy. So, at that definition, we can say that GDP of that particular economy is 3 lakhs. Now, in 2019, so the same 3 bikes were produced at the cost of 1.5 lakh each, and this resulted in a GDP of 4.5 lakhs. Now, this is a 1.5 lakh increase in GDP. That means this is a nominal growth. Now, if you take the case in a real terms, the price of that particular bike in the base year is only 1 lakh, and this says that there is no real growth because 1 lakh into 3 bikes is still 3 lakhs and there is no difference in real terms. That is to say, we cannot always rely on inflation as an indicator for economic growth. Unless and until we raise the supply as well as demand, both should match, only then inflation will have actual meaning. What do I mean by this? Inflation due to supply side constraints is not desirable because people are spending more for the same number of goods available in the market. Now, this is a good sign for traders in the short term, but a bad sign for economy overall in the longer term. Inflation should ideally be caused because of demand. There should be increase in demand which will lead to rise in wages. Only when this happens, the circular flow of economy will be smooth and there will be actual economic growth. Now, we are always emphasizing on nominal GDP growth in the past few weeks because we are not able to grow in real terms. Now, what is the problem with this nominal GDP growth? As seen already, this nominal GDP growth takes into consideration inflation. But in this case, we are talking about a 5 trillion economy. That is, we are taking into consideration the value of US dollars at present exchange rate. Now, what is this exchange rate and how is it linked to our inflation? We have to take that into consideration. Now, if we want to use nominal GDP as a policy tool, we have to take into consideration the inflation in US as well. Unless and until the inflation in US is less than the inflation in India, there is no reason why investors will invest in India. If the interest rates on government securities is higher in US, an investor would prefer US as a destination for investment rather than India because US has a better sovereign bond rating than India. US is a AAA plus rated country and India is not on par with US. So this makes US a more preferred destination. Luckily for India, the situation is not so, but India has a higher interest rate, which is very beneficial for an investor, but it is not so in the case of an economy. If you take the perspective of an economist, he would not want a scenario where there is no real growth and India is relying on nominal growth. So when the real growth is absent, meaning that there are no investments in an economy, there is no increase in volume or output, and we are solely relying on inflation as a factor for growth. That is what nominal GDP means, right? In such scenario where we don't have the capacity to produce for our own population, we have to rely on imports to meet our needs. So as a result, there will be a scenario where the demand for dollar increases and demand for rupee decreases because we have to trade with other countries. In such a scenario, whatever inflation that we are managing and whatever inflation that is used to show nominal GDP growth, all this inflation will be corroded because of depreciation in rupee value. This factor is not talked by many economists who are suggesting that we should focus on nominal GDP growth rate. There is a reason why we always focus on real GDP growth rate as a policy term. It is because the other macroeconomic factors are equally important to add any value to the economy. So in simple terms, to put this article in a simple way, the only way India can achieve a 5 trillion economy is by sheer luck, where US currency, that is the US dollar, will perform very badly, or we have to ensure that Trump maintains a very low inflation or zero inflation. Both these scenarios are not in our hands, and hence there is every reason to focus on structural reforms and ensure that real growth takes place. We have to stop chasing targets beyond our reach and focus on adding value to the lives of the people, and that is possible only through real growth and by job creation. Sound macroeconomic indicators are a prerequisite for any economic success. That is the gist of this article. The last article for the day is taken from the Live Mint and it is titled "Matters of Personal Liberty Should Not Get Short Shrift." So recently, the ex-chief minister of Jammu and Kashmir were charged under the Public Safety Act, according to which the government can detain a person for 2 years without a trial. Now, before this, Public Safety Act, which is a detention law, was imposed on Farooq Abdullah, the ex-chief minister of Jammu and Kashmir, a writ petition or the habeas corpus petition was filed by Rajya Sabha MP Vaiko. Now, despite filing this habeas corpus petition, the Supreme Court did not take up its matter because it was loaded with other cases. Now, a preliminary study about the number of habeas corpus cases that Supreme Court took up in last decade, that is from 2010 to 2015, the paper on this particular research showed that the cases in this particular time period is just 2.2%. That is, only 0.2% of the cases that came to Supreme Court are habeas corpus cases. Now, habeas corpus under Article 32 of the Constitution forms one of the most important fundamental rights that should be upheld because it pertains to the safety of an individual as well as the dignity of the individual against arbitrary action of the state. Now, just because the Supreme Court did not act on this petition, it gave time for the government to impose the Public Safety Act, which is a detention law, on Farooq Abdullah. Because of this act, he can now be detained without any trial for nearly 2 years. This is not a one-off case, and the present inaction of the judiciary is giving a free hand to the executive. That is the accusation made by the article writer. So we need to focus upon limitation of government's arbitrary powers and ensure that judiciary steps up to protect individual rights, especially in the case of writ petitions like habeas corpus, which are the basic expectation of a citizen. Now, if we take a look at the history, Supreme Court had a very bad history with respect to habeas corpus cases, and ADM Jabalpur case is a classic example. In this particular case, the court said that whenever there is emergency, this sort of writ petitions or personal liberties will not be guaranteed. So, in 2017, the Supreme Court reversed itself on ADM Jabalpur case. Similarly, in this particular case, the Supreme Court has sent the habeas corpus petition to high courts. When high courts themselves are burdened with overload of cases, at least Supreme Court could have prioritized habeas corpus petitions and disposed them at a very fast pace. Instead, they delegated the work to a lower court. That is a problematic issue, and it is leading to judicial delay. This judicial delay is a cause of concern because we know that justice delayed is justice denied. That is the gist of this article, and that's it for the day. Thank you.